Hey, it's Dr. Amanda with Straightsmile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and this is an updated infographic to one I made about a month ago. It seems like almost every day one of you guys is secure mailing me a case, you know, some final photos where you think the case is done. It's like an Invisalign or a clear correct or just some clear aligner case, and you're like, is this done? Can I make retainers? Patient's happy. And I'm like, whoa. Have you walked it through the workflow? And I realize you guys don't have the same workflow that orthodontists have in our head that we can just see all this. So I did my best to mind map it out and make an org chart for you the best possible. So this is a second generation of the org chart that I made last month. So I'll verbally take you through all the things, but I think it's pretty self-explanatory. Start off here, check the alignment, anterior and posterior. Not only do you check the alignment, but patient checks the alignment as well. I always talk about, you know, Hollywooding, making sure you might think something looks good, but maybe they want upper right tooth number 7 to come down a little bit. That's not wrong. It's just cosmetic. So I want to know their opinion. And I want to make sure they actually maybe even do it at home and take some time to talk about that. So everyone needs to be happy with this, you know? I don't want to put pressure on them. Usually, you know, the patient comes to me and says, this looks great. I'm happy. Am I done? That's the cue for me to get in there and kind of dig around. Now, if I see like lower right 5, I'm trying to get my numbers right, tooth number 29, a little bit rotated, I'm going to point it out to the patient, but that's not necessarily a deal breaker. I'm going to say, hey, I'm really happy with your front teeth. I noticed this one back tooth is a little bit rotated. I just want to point it out. Is that a problem? Do you want to fix it? It's not a problem with me functionally. It's just not perfect. And my job is to make everything as perfect as possible, unless you're cool with it and you don't want to, you know, like, and if they say, nah, I don't care. If as long as it's not a health problem, then I'm going to document that on the Debond form and say number 29 was not fully rotated. Patient, you know, said that was okay or something like that. Obviously, I'm going to say it better than that, but I'm going to point that out because I don't want this to come back and bite me later where the patient was like, you didn't finish, you know, or another dentist, maybe the patient, I've had this happen before where a patient transfers to another dentist, maybe for retainer checks in a different state. And they're like, oh, you didn't finish the case because you didn't fix this and this. And I'm like, well, a patient said it was okay. Well, unless I had it documented and the patient signed, my, you know, recollection, my notes really doesn't hold any water. And theoretically, you'd have to either give a partial refund or retreat the patient for free. So you want to make sure that you document anything that's not perfect and have the patient sign. So I can't emphasize that enough. So if someone, either you or the patient, is not happy, move on to the next question. That would be question number 2. If some, you know, someone is happy, move on to the next question. If you're not happy, you're going to go ahead and refine. All right. Question number 2, check the bite with articulating paper, tap, tap, grind, grind. We want to see where the contacts are. We want equal and balanced contacts on all posterior teeth. Canine guidance is a plus, but you know, if that doesn't happen, that's not a deal breaker to me, and patients don't even know what that is. So, but I don't want to see anterior teeth occlusion because that's going to cause phrenitis or possible posterior open bites down the line. Could cause damage, could cause wear. And I want to have all those posterior teeth that have an opposing with at least, you know, some type of mark. So, because we don't want to trap an unbalanced occlusion in some Essex retainers. So if this is looking good, you know, if yes, you can skip to the next question. If we have anterior and posterior occlusion, well, then we're probably going to need to refine and fix that. If there's only anterior occlusion, that's a big problem. We definitely need to refine and fix that. If there's some posterior occlusion and no anterior occlusion, but not in every tooth, then maybe we have some options. This is where we have options. We can either refine or we can make fixed bonded upper and lower retainers and let the bite settle for a few weeks to months and then make the Essex once it's settled. And I have a lot of content about that. Or you can make a circumferential Holly retainer, which is like a wraparound Holly retainer, which doesn't really have clasps crossing the occlusion so that the bite can settle. Works in a similar way. This one's better if we started with posterior spaces initially, this is better because it'll keep those spaces from opening up. If you do this one, it's only on the front teeth, so back teeth can move still. You know, they're going to move freely in all different planes of space, whereas here at least they can't rotate or go in and out. They can only go up and down. So this is maybe a little bit better. However, you have less compliance with this than you do with this because this is stuck on. So two different options. In the olden days, we always did this or this. This was pretty common after braces to finish cases. So, or the other option is just to go ahead and refine. If the patient doesn't want this or this, then you can refine, but you got to fix it. All right, so let's say we're all good and we skip to number three. Then you're going to bust out your floss all the, you know, all the contacts in the back, in the front, and see if there's any open contacts. Open anterior contact is not a huge deal as long as the patient's okay with it. Again, that's going to come back up to this issue. I would document it if they say they're okay with it. Open posterior contact kind of depends on how open it is. Is it a perio trap? Is it a food trap? Is it not? Is it big enough that they can clean it? I mean, I don't know why you didn't close it. Maybe it was just too big and you couldn't close it, and then that's okay. Maybe you're having an implant. But I mean, obviously we want to make sure everybody's on the same page about any spaces that are there. If it's just kind of a loose open contact, you probably want to tighten them up. So either you're going to refine or you can do something called ghost IPR. I have content about that. You can search that within my channel. If we're all money, we're good, well, then you can go ahead and make retainers. So these are all the things you need to check every time you have a Debond. I know it's a lot, but if you do all this, you will not have any issues with your retention later, assuming your patient wears it. And you shouldn't have any complaints on your cases either, or less relapse. All right, thanks so much.